Okay, well, that'll work.
All
right, so first thing, well, I suppose I should just kind of tell you what you're looking at here. So yeah, this is the iPad simulator, obviously. This is the toolbar that has a number of functions that will either be using or may already be evident from their icons. A few things that you might want to know from the outset. This is the debugger down here, which you can pull up to cover the screen if you want to get a better look at your debugging area. And then this little refresh or recycle button flips over to the display, which right now is blank because we haven't done anything, but the idea is that this is your canvas that that you paint on or that you add things to. So we'll be flipping that around to see the results of what we're working on once we get to UI related stuff. So let's begin with just kind of going through some of the basic objects that we'll be using. And let me know if I'm going too fast. Let me know if you want me to stop and explain something. I think that these here, these are just your typical black boxes with these are all mathematical operators. So for example, you have this, which is add operation. This is a exponent. This is multiplication. This is the modulus operator. And so as you can see, it has multiple white rectangles, which are the ports. Now, in this framework, inlets or ports that accept input are on the top part of the box, and outlets that send data out are on the bottom. So these are inlets, and this is an outlet. And these two inlets are not exactly the same, as you'll see in a moment. So I'm going to take a couple of these number boxes, which are also boxes in their own right, but serve a different function. And I'm going to connect them to the ports of the addition box, just like that. And then I'm going to take one and I'm going to connect it to the outlet. So we've now got an addition box, and we've got three number boxes to show us the inputs and outputs. So let's start adding some numbers. So as you can see, I enter a number into this box. It passes through the addition box and gives us a 10 on the other side. So it's 10 added to 0. So let's put a number in the other inlet. And the number doesn't change. Now, there is a reason for that, which is that not all inlets are the same. There are hot and cold inlets. A hot inlet, like this one on the left, is an inlet which causes the box to immediately perform its calculation when an input value is received. So that's why whatever number I enter into that box, I get a sum coming out of the outlet. Whereas in the left or cold inlet, I have to update the hot inlet in order to get the sum. So this ends up being very useful later on, but just for now, the 30,000 foot point of view is there are cold and hot inlets. We've got a few convenience sort of objects like a numeric slider, which is normalized to 0 through 1, and it's just a convenient way to generate numbers, which comes in handy. So we have black boxes, we have number boxes, we have sliders. This is a very important object here. These are called bang boxes. So a bang, which is terminology just lifted directly from peer data, a bang is an event. A data flow program requires events in order to do anything, in order to cause processing to happen. And so bangs are basically a message that says, now, do it. Whatever it is, just do it. And not all objects respond to that, but many of them do. There's also a load bang, which is a box that sends out a bang once when the program is first loaded. One other object that's pretty important, and then I'm probably going to skip over some of these other ones so we can get to the good stuff. And that's a message box. So the message box you can sort of treat as a text field, which means that you can type your text into it and Jell-O world. And it takes your text and it holds it. And it actually persists it from one launch to the next. So this is the equivalent of, defining a hard-coded variable, you could say. But it does end up coming in handy. So message boxes, you know, are good for setting particular values in a program. They can hold various data types, including strings, numbers, arrays, and they don't immediately change in response to input. So, for example, if I send this might cause it to crash. I don't know. Oh, okay, never mind. So theoretically, you need to first prepend or put in front of the data a set message, which causes the message box to know, oh, hey, I need to change my value. Now, in this case, obviously, there's something wrong. But it is what it is. So, we have boxes, we have bangs, we have messages. It's sort of it's kind of the basic lingo. So, good with that. Let's take a little step up the ladder here. And let's look at some flow control. So, when your entire program consists of a configuration of boxes that handle data, it becomes very important to know how that data is being routed. So, as a consequence, it's very important to have granular control over things like sequencing of when messages are sent. And so for that, we have several objects, and one of the most important is the trigger object, which is what that T stands for there. So a trigger object is an object that has a single inlet and multiple outlets that delivers a specified event to a downstream port in a particular sequence. And the convention here is that messages are delivered from first on the right-hand side to last on the left-hand side. Now, what we should be able to do here is when I hit this bang box, the bang should travel to this message box then this, then this, then this, and they're all going to this print box, which is going to print them to the debugger. So, assuming I haven't overlooked anything important, let's see if that holds. And so we can see that it does. So this ends up being very important when you get into very delicate operations. This is another use of the trigger box. This time, instead of B's, we have V's, which stands for value. So in other words, rather than sending a bang when the trigger box receives its input, it just sends that value through, and it sends it in a specific order. So we hit the bang box, and we get hello world in the correct sequence. Here's another, this one's kind of a monstrosity visually, but it doesn't bite. So here we have another flow control object, the route object. I'll see if I can get onto the margin here. Well, that's all right. So the route object, similar to the trigger in that it has a single inlet and multiple outlets, but its arguments, the numbers that follow the route word there, have a different significance here, which is that they're used to sort data as it comes in. And so what a route object does, depending upon the data type that it receives, is it looks at the first element of an array or at the first key of a dictionary and it says, am I supposed to be looking for this? And if it is, it trims that element and sends the rest through. So here we have some message boxes which are prepended with digits, zero, everything, one, in, two, its. And the idea here is that although everything is going to a single inlet, we should be able to get them to go to their correct places because they're prepended with numbers, which the router recognizes. And so we get everything in its place. And I have a few more of these, but I think you'll just kind of pick them up as we go along. The counter makes waffles. Just kidding. It counts. So one more kind of introductory piece here I want to show you. And this is one of my favorite features, which is the power of abstraction that I was referring to earlier. So here we have a random black box, and my comment is off screen, but it says, anybody in there? So, well, let's find out. Pull that up a little bit so we can see what the response is. And let's send it a bang. It says, ouch. Let's try again. Hey. Knock that off. Ouch. Hey, stop. Well, obviously, whoever's on the other side of that inlet doesn't want to have anything to do with us. So let's try the right inlet. Well, that's not very helpful. So let's look inside the box. And so now we've opened the box, and we can see how it's implemented, and we can change it. And those changes will take effect immediately. So here you can see I just have a little counter set up that is bounded, lower bound at zero, and then it passes through a modulo 3 box, which means that we just get a repeating sequence of 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2. We have this select box, which sends out a bang when it gets a particular number, and that's how we get that repeating sequence of ouch, hey, knock that off. Whereas on this side, we just have a single message. So anytime you send an event into that inlet, you're going to get nobody here but us chickens, which isn't very helpful. So let's change it to don't bother him. He's having a bad day. So, and we could change anything we want about this box, but right now I just want to demonstrate that you can make changes to the internals of an object, and you don't have to recompile. It's just it's already running. So that's what I mean when I say real-time editing. Now that's not always going to be true, but often it is. So that give you kind of a bit of a idea of how this works. So you want to look at something actual? Yeah.
How can we tell that lower box contains what you showed us on the right?
Well, it'll respond to any change we make to it. So for example, we could do something like this. Get a number box, and let's change the modulo argument to a 1. So what's the result of that going to be? So instead of counting 0, 1, 2, it's just going to say 0, 0, 0, which means it's going to say nothing but ouch.
Right. I understand that logic is contained in that box, but I don't see visually how you made that connection.
Oh, between opening this box?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's, it doesn't, it should open up, right? You should be able to tell that you're looking inside it. It's, yeah, this is, perhaps not, you know, the best visual representation of it, but, I guess take my word for it that, you know, any changes that you make within this specific box will be immediately reflected in the next level up. And hopefully we'll see some more examples that'll go to that point.
Can you name that black box whatever you want?
Yeah. Now, this one's just called black box because I used it for the PowerPoint slide. There's nothing important going on inside it, so. But yeah, you could call it whatever you want. Although, at least right now, there's no protection against collisions in namespace. That's something that will have to come at some point. But theoretically, you can call it whatever you want. What I've been doing is using dot syntax to organize projects. So, for example, the library folder, contains these various categories: animation, rect, layout, rectangles, user interface, utilities, and they're nested by dot syntax. And that is helpful in some ways. I don't know if it's how things will. I'm going to keep things that way, but. But yeah, if you wanted to call it, Jerry Lee Lewis, you could. Okay, so let's look at one of the use cases. So I called this one sensors, which is probably a bit of a misnomer because since we're on the simulator, we don't have access to motion sensors, Bluetooth sensors, and a few other important sensors. We can simulate the location sensor, the GPS. So that's what we're going to do. Now, another way of framing this could be to say that here with this box here, we've taken an entire framework, or at least a large part of a framework, that being core location, and abstracted it within BlackBox so that we don't have to handle the implementation details of responding to notifications, removing notification listeners, keeping a delegate for the location manager object, etc. So all this object does is really just one thing. And that is, it tells you the user's location. So in order to get that, I'm going to take a print object. And I'm going to send a 1 into the inlet. And it's simulating, I think, a city drive right now. Or we could simulate Apple. So we're sitting still now. And when we're done with it, we just send it 0, and it's done. Shuts off. So when I say the level of abstraction is arbitrary, obviously there are a lot of features of the core location framework that aren't being leveraged here, right? But they could be. There's no reason they couldn't be. It's just a matter of a design decision. Do you think that you will need to have access to those features regularly, or do you just need the user's location so you can query a server about nearby, whatever, restaurants or something? So that's sort of a simple, gentle introduction to how you can make this work. Now, it's not really that simple, however, because let's say that we turn on the GPS and we get a location, and we keep getting this same location over and over and over again. Now, suppose there's something downstream, like say a call to Foursquare's API that takes these coordinates as an argument. We don't want the application calling the server every single time it updates. That would be a waste of battery and data. So we have to manage that somehow. And basically what it comes down to is a matter of how you route the data. So we're going to just kind of walk through a solution to that so you can get an idea of what sorts of problems you would encounter in a framework like this and how you might solve them. So the first thing we can do is we can take this change box. And what the change box does is it only allows a value through if it is not the same as the previous value. So if I disconnect the print box here and hook it up to the outlet of the change box and then connect the GPS, we get the first value, but that's it. So this is sort of the equivalent maybe of using the monitor significant location updates notification in the core location framework. It's doesn't have as much granularity, but perhaps that's not what you need in a particular case. So great, well, we've prevented those server calls, unnecessary server calls, from happening, but now I need my location for something else, and suddenly I don't have it. So what do? Well, a little more routing and we should have that problem solved. So the coordinate comes out of the GPS and comes into the change box. The first value will get through. After that, nothing else is getting through unless it changes. But we want to have it on demand. So we store it here in a value box. Value box is just a generic object storage mechanism, essentially. And the way it works is you send the value you would like to store into the write inlet. And when you would like to retrieve that value, you send a bang to the hot inlet. Now, right now, it's not going to have a value in it because we just hooked it up. So let's see here. I think we can trick the change box, maybe. We'll see. Or alternatively, you can just reload it so that the change box doesn't have this idea. Okay, so
bypass the change box.
You could. Yeah, actually, that's a great point. You could just send the GPS directly in there, and there's not really any reason not to do that. But for the sake of closing the circle, let's put it here. Oh, you know what? I did have a reason for using that. Okay, so let's add an additional requirement. So not only do we want to have that value available on demand, but we still want to make sure that new values get passed through immediately. Now, if we sent the output of the GPS directly into the cold inlet of the value, we would have that value available on demand, but we would only get the value when we ask for it. And so we can construct a path for the data that gives us the best of both worlds, like so. Let's see here. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to take that change box, and when a value comes out the outlet, we know that it's going to be a new value. So we're going to take that value and send it into the cold inlet of the value box. And then we're going to take, using the trigger, we're going to send it to a bang, which is then going to cause that value to come out of the value box just when it arrives. But at the same time, we can still query it anytime we need. So let's see if that works. So let's turn on the GPS. So we got that first value. Now if we decide later that we want to access it, it's there. Okay, great. So we've got something set up that will allow us to query the location on demand and get new updates, but it isn't very useful where it's sitting right now because GPS data in absence of any context is not of great value. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this, which is an inlet. This is what an inlet looks like on the inside of a box. And we're going to wire that up to the number box. So in other words, when we send a 1 into that inlet, it's going to go into the GPS and trigger the beginning of location updates. Then we're going to take this other inlet. We're going to connect it to that bang box. That way, we have one inlet that lets us start and stop location updates, and we have another inlet that we can send a bang to anytime we want to get that value again. And then we're going to take an outlet and hook it up to the value, and we now have a box that we can use elsewhere.
So let's
do that. Now I think it's sensors, plural. If it's not, it's just gonna crash, no big deal. Yeah, all right. So now we've got a box that contains what we just did. We can now use it for any other purposes we'd care to. Let's just verify that it's doing what we want it to. Okay, we'll send it a 1. We get our location. And if we need it again, it is available. Now, this, what you're looking at right here, this is not the same instance of that patch or box that we were just looking at. This is a new instance of that, whereas before, in the earlier example, we were looking at the same instance. So, for example, if I were to look at the internals of this box, we would find that its values don't match those contained in this box. So, okay, so that's just sort of a, yeah.
Sorry, can I interrupt? I have just a couple questions.
Yeah.
So is it possible to make a black box be a like a static, like a class instance versus
Yeah.
Object.
In the sense that it is, there's only one.
Right.
I hadn't thought about it. But it's an interesting question. Yeah, I think so. I think what you would do is, so every box has its boxness, and then underneath it has an object that actually routes the data. And I don't see any reason why you couldn't use a singleton instance for that. Yeah, well, actually, there might be, we might be coming up on an example that will be similar in that you're going to see an example of a black box that, although it's not the only instance that can exist within a patch, it does have global visibility in the same way that class method or in a singleton would. So we'll see that when we get to the UI stuff.
Okay, can I ask another quick question?
Yeah.
So we had the 2 inlets on that patch you built. How does it know, is it just positionally whether they're connected to the hot and cold as to whether they'll be the inlet, the hot and cold inlet of the actual black box?
Yeah. Or not? Well, see, that's a good question. Now, when you're building, actually, that gets to kind of a useful distinction that might be good to talk about now, which is that that a hot inlet versus a cold inlet is something that you specify when you're writing what in pure data they call an external. An external is an object that you can double click on it and you can't open it. And that's because it's written in Objective-C. So let's see if I can find a good example here. So this is an example. This one's the add key. It adds a route key to the beginning of an object. And the by default, it has a hot inlet and a cold inlet. Now, when you're building a box out of other components, that's actually, it's sort of a different thing. Even though they look very similar, they behave very similarly, in pure data terminology, which generally speaking I'm just sort of ripping off wholesale, that would be considered an abstraction. And abstractions, at least as I've implemented them for now, have only hot inlets. Anytime you send something in, it's going to...
So is it right and left? Is it based on its position there, or hot? Like, what if I want to switch the bang?
Yeah. That is, right now it's just based upon the sequence you add them in, which needs to change. It should be positional.
Okay.
So if I move this inlet over here, when we look at it from the outside, it's still going to think, or it's still going to say that, no, this is the left inlet and this is the right inlet. And that's because this one was added first. And it, at least right now, it doesn't update that based upon position. But it should, because otherwise it's confusing. And there are all kinds of reasons why you might want to reposition a port. Any other questions? Or move on? All right.
How would you know which one was added first if you were looking at it?
Well, you wouldn't. you try to remember. No, it's not a good it's not a good setup to just do it sequentially. And everything that I've done thus far, whenever I think, okay, I should do it differently than pure data does it, I always come to the conclusion that that was a bad idea. And the way that pure data does it is that it's positionally determined which inlet is which. And that just makes the most sense from just a logical and intuitive perspective. But it's one of those things so you can select, you can copy, you can paste, but at least so far I have yet to implement a feature where you can move all the selected objects at once, which would be such a time saver, but for some reason I just haven't gotten around to it. Yeah.
Couple questions.
Yeah.
Is there any limitation on composition of boxes? Like, can you have a box within a box within a box within a box, layer it?
Theoretically, there's no limitation on it. Well, actually, no. I should. In theory, you could have. I think you could have a million individual boxes before you would start to run into collisions in namespace. So this is kind of another interesting thing that we haven't touched on, which is there is a locality, which is accessed. There's another way that you can send messages via the send and receive objects, and if you include $0 in the name of the send or receive box, that means that message is only visible to other objects within the same box. If I left the $0 off, then it would be broadcast globally. But that ID is a random integer between 0 and, I think, a million. So hence, theoretically, that's the limit. In practical terms, I've nested things pretty deep and sort of felt like the processor was having a bit harder time. There are ways that you could optimize that. In terms of trying to understand it compositionally, there's not really any limitation on it.
And as inlets and outlets, can you have multiple inputs into a single inlet and multiple outputs? Or is it a one-to-one?
In theory, it's multiple. In practice, I think that it accepts connections to multiple. And the reason I'm equivocating on it is because at some point not that long ago it was only one-to-one. And I believe it's fixed, but you know.
And that answers our last question.
Yeah.
I noticed that several of the objects are different colors. I'm wondering if that was just, or what that meant.
Oh, do you mean this?
No, there was, on some of your other examples, there were, instead of the boxes being black background, they were like a light background.
Oh, maybe the message boxes?
Possibly.
These guys?
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's just sort of a visual cue to let you know that it's a different kind of object. Since it doesn't really have any internals that are interesting to us, but is more of just like a container for a value. And that's how pure data does it. And as we've covered, I'm pretty much just ripping that off wholesale. So
is pure data the market leader or conceptual leader or just the only thing out there in this space?
I think it's just something that I have an affinity for. It has a following, and it's been out there since 1998, and it's more popular than ever. I don't know that they're really. I would have a tough time telling you who the market leader is in that space, because it's just open source, open source C code that, you know, that's free. So I guess the reason I keep saying, you know, pure data, is just because I love it. I just spent so much time using it. It's so familiar to me. I really understand its ins and outs. And so, you know, when I'm trying to build something for a different purpose, it a lot of times makes sense to refer to that as a model and modify it as needed. But I would definitely encourage you to take a look at it, because it does have some really interesting applications, including running on Raspberry Pis, algorithmic composition, video processing, all sorts of different things.
How does something like this compare to something like the name?
So you saw an example of one of the classes. Here, I'll show you that again. So this is the implementation. And there's the header file and my voluminous documentation. But as you can see, there's really not much in here. There's a setup method, and then there's a calculate output method. So obviously this is a subclass, and some of the heavy lifting is being done by the superclass. So let's look at that. So this is the header file for the abstract superclass. It is a little bit bigger, but it's still 91 lines for the header. Implementation goes on a little bit more, but it's around 300. And that's not because I'm, you know, a poet. It's because it's just really, the idea of how it works is really very simple. It's just, I have it, now you have it, now you have it, now you have it. And in this case, key value observing is the mechanism that ties it together. But there's no reason it would have to be that. It could be notifications or any other asynchronous method of transmitting a value between objects that otherwise know nothing about each other. So to get back to your original question, once you get past that superclass stage, the sort of the architecture of, you know, kind of the main object, they probably diverge pretty rapidly because they're, you know, made for very different purposes. Mm-hmm. But at this stage, they're probably going to be very similar. Anything else? All right, cool. So let's get to the real stuff then. Not that this wasn't real, but I think you'll like this next one. So everybody has to work with REST APIs, or almost everybody. So I put together a few patches to show you how you can go about interacting with a REST API, including parsing the response and formatting the request. So now these, obviously, they don't really tell you much about what's inside. That's kind of the point. But let me just show you, in general terms, what you can do with them. So this is the, This is the Foursquare API. Venue search, I think, is the endpoint that it's looking at. I'll show you what it looks like in action, then I'll show you what's inside. But first, I want to get that GPS patch that we made. So I'm taking the sensors patch, and I'm just sending the output to the Foursquare API patch. So the Foursquare API patch takes a latitude-longitude pair as its sole input argument, and then outputs nearby venues. Now, keep in mind, we're using a simulated location, so it's going to be stuff near Cupertino. And I have a few other things over here that might be of use to us. So I'm going to hook that up to a print response, clear the log, and let's get some data, hopefully. And the debugger definitely isn't as easy to use as the debugger in Xcode. You don't have highlighting, that sort of thing that would make it easier to use, and obviously you don't have the advantage of breakpoints, but you don't necessarily need them in this context. So the first thing we do is, let's just kind of look through the response and get an idea of what's in here. So these are supposedly venues near Apple. Now, I checked some of these out insofar as I looked at their names, and I'm pretty sure this is not a real place. Go, 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 go. Now, there are things we could do about that in terms of filtering. But I kind of want to first show you how you could parse a response like this. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's take a look at what is inside. So, this is the box that's responsible for taking that point, creating a formatted request, GET request, sending it to the server, and then taking the response. So I'll get to this upper part in a moment, but first, just to kind of give you an idea of where the heavy lifting is being done, we have this client box, which is AF networking in a can or in a box. Right now, it's just GET requests. It could easily be configured to include post, delete, and other RESTful methods. But for my purposes right now with testing, I'm just using a GET request. So I assume some of you are familiar with AF networking, and it's actually almost embarrassingly simple how small that class is. So this is the client class. It's pretty lightweight. Now in terms of the contents of this patch, let's rotate it so you can get a better look. So visual spaghetti is a real thing, but I do think that this has a certain almost biological appearance to it that I find kind of agreeable. So what are we doing here? Well, first of all, our point comes in, and there's a fair amount of hemming and hawing that we have to do in order to get that into the format that's actually useful to us. Like I was saying, the DFP equivalent of boilerplate is type conversion. So here, first we're going to, we've got a little buffer here called the array accumulator, or array accum, that's going to store values. So first we need to clear that buffer. Next, we use this trigger object to send the point to an object that splits it into numeric values rather than a wrapped CG point struct. So then it's going to take those two values and store them in value boxes. It's then going to send them to this array accumulator, which is going to take those two values and note the sequence in which they're added to the array, right? First X, then Y. And then once that's done, we send a bang to the array accumulator, which flushes its contents out. We then send it through another trigger. This trigger is going to do a couple of things. It's going to first send a format string into a format string box, which is a little confusing, but basically this is the equivalent of NS string, string with format. This is the format string, and you're sending the arguments into the hot inlet. And out comes a formatted string that you can then pass to the next stage. So we send that formatted string down, and these are hard-coded values. Obviously, hard-coding your credentials is not good practice. At this moment, there's no encryption in the framework, but you know, that's definitely something that will have to be addressed at some point. But for now, you can just think of this as early stages of a project. You sometimes hard code your key and your secret just because it's easier than storing it somewhere. And then we use these add key boxes to basically transform each value into a key value pair. So this value sent through key client secret becomes a dictionary with one key value pair, that being client secret and the value, the key, this long string. These all pass into a dictionary accumulator, which takes all of those and puts them into a single dictionary until it receives a bang, at which point it flushes that dictionary down to the next stage, to this format request, external, you can't open it. First, it sends the dictionary into the far right inlet. Next, it sends the base URL into the middle inlet, and then sends a bang saying, okay, we're done, next stage. Finally, we're gonna send that formatted request string into the cold inlet of the client, and then a bang to say, okay, let's go. And that is where we got the data. Now, I have a few others that you can take a look at here. I think the one I want to do a little bit of work with is this Foursquare nearby. So it has kind of some cool properties, but formatting a request can be kind of individual. There are certain elements of reusability, and there are certain patterns that recur, but there is a reason why these are separate boxes for separate APIs, because you know, the keys are going to be a little bit different. Now, theoretically, you could pull out all of that hard-coded stuff, and you could use a reusable template, but you know, at this point, I guess I'm just sort of more interested in just making it work. So so here we have Pixabay, which is a free image hosting service, which we might make use of later if there's time. This is Wikipedia's extracts. And here you can see, visually at least, some definite similarities in the form, especially once you zoom out. You can see it's a little bit shorter than Foursquare's, but the general plan is kind of similar. And if you look at what the actual flow of the data is here, it is quite similar. So you have a trigger, you have various hard-coded keys, which don't need to be hard-coded, but are right now. You have a base URL, a formatted request going to a client. And that's sort of how all of them look on the inside. But we can do more than just get the data. We can actually do stuff with it. So let's take this Foursquare API nearby. The difference between this box and the one that we hooked up our sensor to is that rather than a latitude-longitude position, this one takes a name of a geographic location. And it also returns a different result set. So let's just send it a request here and get a look at what we're going to try to work with. And I'm going to get a value box so I can save that response. Oh yeah, no problem. All right. All right, so let's just search Minneapolis. All right, so assuming the request went through, when I hit the bang box, it should send that response out and we can look at it. So let's first clear what we already have. Okay, good. So there is our response. I don't know if any of you have ever use the Foursquare API in your production code, it's kind of a pain because it's very deeply nested, and it's not always immediately apparent just from looking at the response how that's structured in terms of the data types. So so you end up having to use sort of recursive approaches to check to see if it's an array, and if it's an array, you do one thing with it. If it's a dictionary, you do another thing with it. And I don't know, I feel like I burnt up a lot of time on one, at least one project trying to set up that response parsing. So last night I was working on seeing if it could be done more easily. And I don't know, judge for yourself. Okay, so first thing is we want to get an idea of what's something interesting in here that we might want to grab from this response. I don't know, the venue name would be good. The category name might be interesting. A little bit more of a challenge too, since it's more deeply nested. Phone number would be good. I mean, there's a lot of useful information here, but you know, for our purposes, we just kind of want to demonstrate how it might work. So let's get the category name, and let's get the venue name. So we have two different items that we want to pull from this response. Now, in order to do this, we have to have some idea of what the structure of the response is, though we don't have to understand it perfectly. So, for example, we know that the two main pieces of the response are going to be this metadata, a code that indicates that it was a successful call to the server, and then a response. Now, we would want to check that code in production code, the meta code, to make sure we can show an error message or retry. But for right now, we're assuming that it's working. So we're just going to look in the response portion. So once we, let's assume that we can get the response, this portion, then the next thing we're going to want to grab will be the venues, which are nested within the response in some way, although it's not entirely clear how. I believe the venues are an array. Yeah. So we need to drill into response, then venues, and then categories, then name. Response, venues, categories, name. Okay, I'll try to remember that. So now the routing object is kind of an obvious first thing to try, because as I said, the routing object takes the first element of an array or a dictionary, and if it finds the key it's looking for, it pulls it off and sends the rest through, which is great, because in a nested response like this, that's precisely what we want. We want to grab this key, venues, pull it off, and get this array right here. And then within that array, we want to grab categories, pull it off, and then we want to drill into here. Grab name, pull it off, and be left with the category, restaurant. So how do we do that? Routing is definitely part of the solution, but it's not the only part, because as I said, it's not always clear whether you're working with an array or a dictionary. I believe that the type safety component of BlackBox is at least sufficiently advanced that it won't crash if it gets the wrong type, but it also won't get you what you want. So I came up with with this last night. I think this is pretty useful, and it's kind of cool because it demonstrates how you can do recursion in this environment. So I believe it's API util ODR, which means optional drip or serialize array, and then route. It's kind of a silly naming convention, I know, but actually, no, I want to use multiple optional drip and route. So I think this will be the first box that you've seen where you're seeing me use creation arguments. And so in this case, we're going to give it the creation arguments response, which is the first key that we want, and then venues, which is the second key. So only a single outlet on this because the purpose is different than a route object. Here we're not looking for everything else. We want something specific, and we don't want anything else besides that specific thing we're looking for. So let's just, that's not going to get us all the way to where we want to be, but let's just see what it gets us. So I'm going to disconnect the print object, hook it up to here, and then I'm going to take that stored response and send it in to the multiple optional drip then route. And that's pretty good. It got us a lot closer. All these, so these are, you know, if you looked at that original response, nested within the venues was this data. So we have successfully discarded everything that's not venues. But that still doesn't get us where we want to go. So we have to add an additional multiple optional drip then route. This time, our keys are going to be categories and name. Now, what we should get as an output is the category names of all the venues. So that's at least that's what I'm hoping we get. I'm going to clear the log again, and here we go. And it's obviously, like, without the, you know, the context, without the name of the venue that it's associated with, it's you know, it's of somewhat limited use, but we're going to fix that now. So downstream from this first MODR object, we have just the venues, right? So we can use the output from that and then just filter it specifically for the name of the venue, I think. So we don't have to create a separate object like this, although maybe we should, because I don't know if the response is an array or what. So let's do this. Let's take, disconnect this, and let's explicitly sequence this so that we know that the name of the restaurant or the name of the venue is being associated with the correct category. So I'll show you how you do that. We're going to put in a trigger object that is first going to send the output of this first MODR to here, where we're going to get the category name, and then after that we're going to put a single ODR, so not multiple optional drip. That's a silly name. But when you have to type out the whole path, you know, you go for the the abbreviations. So I believe I'm just gonna want name. Oop, all right, messed something up. Oh yes. Auto completion is a high priority. Okay, so what this should do is it should handle any arrays that come in, but still just look for the key name that's associated with the venue. Now the last thing we need to do is we need to make sure that they get paired up correctly. So I just fixed this object today. I'm not sure if it's working, but we'll see. This is called the array pack, which takes creation argument just specifying a particular number of values, which you list out. And what it does, sort of like route in reverse. So it's going to take the category name and it's going to hold on to it until it gets the venue name. Once it has both, it's going to send it through. So let's print that. It's going to be name and category. Now, I don't know if this is going to work. Hopefully. Well, that one appears to have worked. Why we only got that one, I don't know. But actually, I bet I do. And it's related to something that's not interesting. So, I could futz with a different approach. Theoretically, that object will work and give you arrays with each of the names and categories. I suppose that's a little underwhelming. Nightingale. Well, anyway, so assuming you would like to see some of the UI stuff and that it's late and we probably shouldn't go on too much longer, is everybody satisfied with this?
Sure, cool.
And there's obviously, you could talk about it for a long time, but okay. So yeah, that is the REST API case. So the last case is the UI. This part I wasn't sure I was going to be able to come up with anything for, but it's getting somewhere. It's a little bit tougher to deal with these sorts of objects with views than it is to deal with things like arrays and dictionaries and numbers, because a view is a very specific type of data. But it actually, I think I sort of stumbled onto something that works fairly well. So. First, let me just show you something so that if we need to wrap up soon, you can at least say that I showed you a cool animation, or an animation, not a cool animation. So first of all, what are you looking at? A bunch of stuff. Here is an interesting item. This is the screen on this side. So the first thing we're going to do, and as I mentioned before, the screen does have sort of global visibility. So the first thing I'm going to do is get the bounds of the screen, which is going to tell our other views how they should configure their layout. It's sort of a hack that's approximating auto layout. So now our views should have the correct screens. The next thing we do is hit this bang box, which is going to send a message, initialize view, init view, and that's going to go over here. So what's going to happen there? It's going to send this view message to a value box, which is holding the bounds of the screen, and that's going to go into a box that's going to create an inset rectangle with an inset of 200 on each side, and then we're going to add an init specifier or key in front of it, and then that's going to go into this box, templates.view UI view. So it's just a UI view, and then that's going to go to this send add subview. So let's just see what it looks like. Okay, so the view is created, but we don't see anything because the view is white, and so is the screen. So over here, we've got an array of four values. That's RGB alpha, goes through a little conversion box, which takes those values and turns them into a UI color, which we then add a key to, so that it gets routed properly. And then we add one more key, the set key, which says basically, set the background color of this view to this color. And something's funky with the interface here, but yeah, there you go. So there's our rectangle. Now let's make it dance. So we've got this object, which is the keyframe animation object. We add an anim route key to it so that it goes to the right inlet on the interior of that object, which I'll show you in a moment. And then into that keyframe animation object, we send these. And these are actually, you know, you can kind of look at and figure out what it's going to do, especially if you've used keyframe animations before. So the key path for the first animation is going to be scale. It's going to go from 0 to 3 on a slightly kind of exponential curve. That 0 is going to wreak havoc with it, so I'm going to get rid of it. Don't know where that came from. And then finally, we're going to tell it the, oh man, I'm just making a mess here. I'll probably just have to rewrite that one. Text parsing is not great. So down here, this is the one you're going to see right now, is rotation around the z-axis. It's going to go from 0 to 6.28 radians, so a complete 360 in 5 seconds, and then I'm going to send it a do message just saying, okay, do it now. And the 0, yeah, it's a long story, I guess. Okay. Here's our animate view. Let's check on it. Okay, it's still there. And now, that's pretty cool. I mean, I don't know anybody that's really interested in seeing a rectangle do a 360, but it's more, there are other things you could do besides rotate a rectangle. If you can do that, there are other things that you should also be able to do. I'm gonna try to fix this here so that we can have two animations at once. So I'm just basically sending an array of arrays to the animation box. So key path transform.scale. So that's the first component of the animation, followed by the values. And we'll go 0, 1. We'll kind of do that curve again. And if you've used keyframe animations before, you'll recognize these are values that you have to specify if you're doing it in Xcode. We'll give it 5 seconds. Tell it to do right away. Okay. Now, what we should get is, while the rectangle is rotating, it should also expand. Check and make sure it's still there. Okay. So that's fine. Now you can set up a keyframe animation to repeat itself, but let's take a slightly different approach here. So this is an object that gets used in pure data quite a bit. The metro object, which is metro is in metronome, a regular pulse, sends out a bang at regular intervals. So we'll create a metro object that sends out a bang at 5 second intervals. So what we should get is a looped animation. So I send the output of the metro to this animate view, and I need to send a 1 into the hot inlet of the metronome in order to kick things off. So yeah, again, not that many people want to look at a spinning rectangle that's also coming toward them. But you know, there are other things you could do with it. Now I'm thinking I should probably start wrapping up, since I also want to be able to answer your questions. There's quite a bit more stuff that that I didn't get to, but that's fine. I mean, eventually it's going to be released, or it'll be in beta, and you can check it out more extensively then. I guess one thing that I do want to point out, I just want to show you how this view object works, because it's, I think, kind of gives you a good insight into the overall direction of the project. So this, as much as it might seem like it's completely different from what already exists, or that it's kind of a reinvention of the wheel in a sense, when you look at the internals here, you'll see that it's actually just a different way of interacting with the existing Cocoa libraries. So, for example, here you see lib.util.factory $1. So the $1 is a substitution argument, or a creation argument, that tells this object what kind of view to create. And so here I specified it as a UI view, but I could specify an image view, a text view, a label, anything that is a subclass of UI view. I could give that as a creation argument, and when I send it that init message, that's what I'll get back. Now, you can interact with that view in a lot of really useful ways from within this box. So this is an external, but it's, I guess you could kind of think of it as a wrapper for UI view. So there are a lot of inlets, which is why I added the additional level of abstraction. But what you have is you can set the view, which also means that this box is not tied to the lifetime of any particular view. It holds one view pointer, or one pointer to a view. But if that view is released or it gets a different view, then that's the end of its relationship with that pointer. While it has that pointer, it can get properties, it can set properties, it can call selectors, add subviews, and do animations. You can extract the layer, the CA layer, from the view, and then you can work with it in much the same way using a layer object, which has the same outlets and inlets. It's just slightly different to deal with the more prevalent usage of C structs in the layer than in the view. Is that all I wanted to say about this? It might be. Yeah, so this is a, I don't know where exactly I got the idea for this way of working with an object in a Dataflow format. I think it's just because I didn't know what else to do. Because views are very different from, you know, the other data types that we've been looking at. But I think that this solution works pretty well because we have, you know, single pointer associated with a single box. You can spawn new views, so you're not limited to what you have when you within the box itself. You can add views. You can keep adding them. Things get a little difficult when you start needing a reference to those views that are no longer being held by a view object. At that point, in order to change that view, you would have to access it through its super view, which is the screen. And the screen is the closest thing to a singleton that, at least that you'll see right now. And the reason for that is because if you look at these sends and receives, none of them have the $0 specifier. That means they're global. So any object anywhere in this project can send and receive messages from this instance of the screen. And there's only one. There could be more, but there's not in this case. So to give you an example of how you can handle views after they're released by their containers. Here's a little patch that clears the subviews in the screen. So what happens is when it gets this clear screen message, it sends subviews to the get inlet of the screen, which is just another view object basically. And it sends it down, routes it via the subviews key to this object, which, ooh, crashes it apparently. That was the first one. So I'll put that view back. Oops. Okay, so now I can show you the clear screen, hopefully. So I send that bang, and our view has now disappeared. So what happened? Well, if I can open this without crashing, I can show you. Otherwise, it'll just have to remain a mystery. No. Apparently, it's going to be a mystery. Maybe not. So it's pretty simple. It takes the array of subviews from the screen, puts it through the array drip, which serializes the array into single views. Once that Once that array's been serialized, we send each view to a view box, an external, followed by a remove from super view selector. And that has the effect of enumerating the entire array of superviews or subviews and removing them. And at some point, I'm going to have to do something more sophisticated for managing views that you no longer have a reference to, if for no other reason than it's probably going to be needed for auto layout, collision behavior, and that sort of thing. There's a way to do it. I just, you know, haven't gotten there yet. So I'll leave it there. And you know, since I have you know, obviously a bunch of other stuff, if you know, we can talk more about it some other time. And now that I've met you all, come to the next meetup. In January, is it?
Yep.
Okay. So we should probably, I guess, keep it somewhat short since we have our dogs are waiting at home, and some of you probably have other little creatures that are depending you waiting for you. But does anybody have any questions?
So maybe I missed something at the beginning, but I'm sorry. What is it for? Can you publish apps, or is it just kind of a programming exercise? Or?
I don't really know. I mean, it's I'm working with the assumption that Apple would not allow this to be sold on the App Store. But I also am fairly certain that they would allow apps to be sold on the App Store that use it. So in other words, as long as it's read-only, you know, one of those text patches that I showed you, there's really no reason why they wouldn't allow that.
But you can make an app from this? You can publish to an application?
I don't know. I think so. You know, that's definitely the goal. Right now, it's just kind of something cool that, you know, is cool enough that I can't really put it down, you know, keep working on it. But I would be surprised if this is ever on the App Store. You know, I think what it'll end up being is some combination of open source and, you know, maybe some kind of white label thing that, you know, organizations could have like an internal version that they use and customize for their own purposes. And then people who, you know, aren't developers within that organization could have an app that can read those patches but can't write them. I can't imagine that they would allow something like this to be on the App Store, because, I mean, in theory, you can create any object from the framework and send it any message, which is, you know, you could, I think, you could certainly crash your iOS device that way. I don't know if you could turn it into a brick, but maybe. Yeah. But I guess the short answer is, I don't know.
I guess I look at this, and I'm going to hate myself here when I say this, but I look at this as the modern version of Turtle, if you know what Turtle is.
No. What is it?
I know. I mean, so Turtle was this old, probably from the 60s, 70s, command line program language where you had this little, it was usually like a little triangle, and that was your turtle. And your turtle can put down a pin, and you could make your turtle move. And you could, you know, do geometric shapes, and you could have your turtle go into loops, and you could draw flowers and boxes and all kinds of stuff.
Just sketch.
Kind of like logo. I mean, it's somewhere between that and a nerd's ultimate Lego.
Yeah, I was thinking about that, the Lego idea.
Yeah, I mean, I have a 6-year-old son, and I would love for him to learn programming. And abstracted. I know when I was in taking the courses, getting a degree, maybe it was lab view or something, but doing electrical circuits.
Yeah.
And very similarly, you could abstract, have higher level objects that were more protected that wouldn't crash and break your iOS device. But I mean, I can imagine things using this for dynamically building stories.
Or, yeah.
Dynamically building an electrical circuit, or animating a roller coaster, or anything like that. I mean, I think there's a lot of.
A guy that I work with, he also has a strong interest in data flow programming. he compared it to HyperCard, which I didn't remember. Mm-hmm. I think that was late 80s, maybe. But apparently, there was a fairly popular blog post a couple weeks ago in which the author was arguing that that's what the iPad needs, is a HyperCard. In other words, you need some sort of tool so that you can get it to do things that are useful to you, in terms of could it be used to build an entire application, I think so. But certainly it could be used to just, do some task. If we had more time, this was in retrospect probably a little overambitious, but what I was kind of thinking was that we would try to take the venue data from Foursquare, combine it with the photos of the city from Pixabay and the description of the city from Wikipedia. And you could take the text and put it into a text view, take the photos and put it into a image view, and take the locations and put it in a map view. And there you have probably kind of an ugly travel app, but a travel app, nonetheless, and I think it would be great if people could do that. Whether Apple's going to see it that way, I don't know. Clearly they realize that something is missing on the iPad, something that prevents it from being truly useful. It's useful, no doubt. It's a great product, but great enough that I want to buy another one, in the next year and a half, 2 years? Not sure.
Very impressive.
Thanks. Really appreciate that. Any other questions? I realize some of you might have other questions, and I'd be really curious to, hear more of what everybody thinks about it, so we can continue the conversation on the meetup board, or next time we see each other in person. So, and I'll keep you posted with updates. By that next meetup, I might have something that's a little closer to being stable. We'll see. So thanks, everybody. Really appreciate you sitting and listening. I've been spending way too much time working on this, as I'm sure Morgan can attest.